And I invite you to join me in prayer as we prepare for worship. Almighty and everlasting God, in whom we live and move and have our being, you created us for yourself, so that our hearts are restless until they find rest in you. Grant to us the strength of heart and power of purpose, that no selfish passion may hinder us from knowing your will, and no weakness from doing it. In your light, may we see life clearly, and in your service find perfect freedom, through Jesus Christ, our Lord. Amen. Would you join me in our call to worship? As we gather today, we call you
our Father, who art in heaven.
As we gather today, we lift up who you are and what you represent.
Hallowed be your name.
As we gather today, we seek your ways, not our own.
Your kingdom come, your will be done.
As we gather today, we say sorry to you and one another.
Forgive us as we forgive.
As we gather today, we need you.
Give us this day our daily bread. Lead us away from temptation and deliver us from evil.
As we gather today, we pray.
Amen. Amen.
Let us join. This morning, our gospel reading is coming from the book of Matthew once again. Verse 22. I thought I had the wrong one marked. Verse 22. Excuse me, chapter 22, verses 34 through 46. And it's entitled, The Greatest Commandment. Hearing that Jesus had silenced the Sadducees, the Pharisees got together. One of them, an expert in the law, tested him with this question, Teacher, which is the greatest commandment in the law? Jesus replied, Love the Lord your God with all your heart and with all your soul and with all your mind. This is the first and the greatest commandment. And the second is like it. Love your neighbor as yourself. All the law and the prophets hang on these two commandments. While the Pharisees were gathered together, Jesus asked them, What do you think about the Christ? Whose son is he? The son of David, they replied. He said to them, How is it then that David, speaking by the Spirit, calls him Lord? For he says, The Lord said to my Lord, Sit at my right hand until I put your enemies under your feet. If then David calls him Lord, how can he be his son? No one should say a word in reply. And from that day on, no one dared to ask him any more questions. This is the word of the Lord. Praise be to God. Please be seated. Now, our unison prayer today is a little bit different. Well, a lot different. This is the translation of the Lord's Prayer from Syriac. Okay. The closest modern language to Aramaic, which Jesus spoke. So, please join me in the unison prayer. O one from whom the breath of life comes, who fills all realms of sound and light and vibration, may your light be experienced in your inner being. Your heavenly domain approaches. Let your true will come true in the union and the earth. Give us wisdom and understanding for our daily need. And release the chains of faults that bind us. like we let go of the guilt of others. Let us not be lost in superficial things, but let us be freed from that which keeps us from our true purpose. From you comes all working will, the lively set to act, the song that beautifies all and renews itself from age to age. Amen. Our Old Testament reading this morning is from Deuteronomy chapter 34, verses 1 through 12. And this is the death of Moses. Then Moses climbed Mount Nebo from the plains of Moab to the top of Pisgah, across from Jericho. There the Lord showed him the whole land, from Gilead to Dan, all of Naphtali, the territory of Ephraim and Manasseh, all the land of Judah as far as the western sea, as the Negev and the whole region from the valley of Jericho, the city of palms as far as Zoar. Then the Lord said to him, "This is the land I promised on oath to Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob, when I said, 'I will give it to your descendants, as I have let you see it with your eyes, but you will not cross over into it.'" Then Moses, the servant of the Lord, died there at Moab, just as the Lord had said. He buried him in Moab, in the valley opposite Beth Peor, but to this day, no one knows where his grave is. Moses was 120 years old when he died, yet his eyes were not weak, nor his strength gone. The Israelites grieved for Moses in the plains of Moab 30 days, until the time of weeping and mourning was over. Now, Joshua, son of Nun, was filled with the spirit of wisdom because Moses had laid his hands on him. So the Israelites listened to him and did what the Lord had commanded Moses. Since then, no prophet has risen in Israel like Moses, whom the Lord knew face to face. Who did all those miraculous signs and wonders the Lord sent to him do in Egypt, to Pharaoh, and to all of his officials, and to his whole land? For no one has ever shown the mighty power or performed the awesome deeds that Moses did in the sight of all of Israel. This is the word of the Lord. Praise be to God.
Many times when we start to learn something new, we need to find someone who already knows how to do it. I once thought I could teach myself on the violin because I had a violin from my great uncle. You notice you have never heard me play the violin. There's a reason for that. I did learn that if you hold the bow correctly, there is no reason to get squeaks and squawks that you so often hear from them. But that was about as far as I got with it. Much better with the piano. Also, much more practice on the piano. How'd you learn to play the organ, Linda? Stand near me.
Okay. When I was in school in 10th grade, there was a lady that went to our church, probably a lot of you knew her, Laura Trapagan, and she played the organ in the old church. And she says, "You want to learn how to play?" And I said, "Yes." And she says, "Well, I'm going down and practice in a few minutes." So, excuse me. I met her at the church, and she showed me what she knew about it. And then she was going to go home, and she said, "Well, if you don't want to play the organ right now," she says, "the piano's right down there." And I said, "Well, if I'm ever going to learn," and of course it was two keyboards, you played the bottom hand over here and the top, whatever. And I thought, I'm going to learn this. And that I just kept on playing it. Every once in a while, I would play the piano. And this one isn't much different. It's a little smaller than our other one, but I really like it.
It takes someone who knows to get us started, or at least it makes it a lot easier. Is there anyone who does any painting, not as a wall, but as a painting?
Judy does.
Did you have someone who kind of showed you some things, or did you look at pictures beforehand to kind of know what you were doing? Looked at some pictures. Sometimes that will work. Well, the disciples asked Jesus, "Teach us to pray." We have a lot of cases where Jesus went away to pray. He tried to get away from the crowds, where he could be alone with God. And they probably wondered what he did while he was there. But a lot of the rabbis taught their disciples to pray a certain prayer. And I don't know if Jesus wanted us to say the Lord's Prayer every day, every time we're together, or if he meant it as a model for us, because it works really both ways. And today we'll work on it a little bit on both directions. I wanted you to hear the lectionary readings, not just because I wanted Cindy to read Deuteronomy.
Yes. After the unison prayer,
that's right. But I wanted to keep up that continuity, but today I'm speaking about the Lord's Prayer. And I think we can use that as a good model and still learn a lot from it. Even though we say it, we don't always pray it every week. Let's pray together. Oh God, thank you for sending Jesus as an example. And thank you for giving us the example of how to pray, how to come close to you, how to understand how to get to know you better. Lord, help us to pray in Jesus' name. Amen. The prayer we know as the Lord's Prayer begins, "Our Father, which art in heaven."
Yes?
Don't interrupt me, I'm praying.
But you called me.
Called you? No, I didn't. I'm praying, "Our Father, which art in heaven."
There, you did it again.
And what?
Called me. You said, "Our Father, which art in heaven." Here I am. What's on your mind?
But I didn't mean anything by it. I was just, you know, just saying my prayers for the day. I always say the Lord's Prayer. Makes me feel good. It's kind of like getting a duty done.
All right. Go on.
Hallowed be thy name.
Hold it. What do you mean by that?
By what?
Hallowed be thy name.
Well, it means... Good grief, I don't know what it means. How should I know? It's just part of the prayer. By the way, what does it mean?
It means honored, holy, wonderful.
That makes sense. Never thought about what hallowed meant before. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven.
Do you really mean that?
Sure. Why not?
What are you doing about it?
Doing? Nothing, I guess. I just think it'd be kind of neat if you got control of everything down here like you have up there.
Have I got control of you?
Well, I go to church.
That isn't what I ask you. What about your temper? You've really got a problem there, you know. And then there's the way you spend your money, all on yourself. And what about the kinds of books you read and what you watch on TV?
Oh, stop picking on me. I'm just as good as the rest of these people here at church.
Excuse me? I thought you were praying for my will to be done. If that is to happen, it will have to start with the ones who are praying for it, like you, for example.
Oh, all right. I guess I do have some hang-ups now that you mention it. Oh, I could probably name some others.
So could I.
Oh, jeez. I haven't thought very much about it until now, but I'd really like to cut out some of those things. It would be like, you know, it'd be really free.
Good. Now we're getting somewhere. We'll work together, you and I. Some victories can be truly won. I'm proud of you.
Look, Lord, I kind of need to finish this up here. It's taking a lot longer than it usually does. Give us this day our daily bread.
You could cut out the bread. It would help you lose weight.
Wait a minute. What is this? Criticize Berry Day? Here I was doing my religious duty, and all of a sudden you break in and remind me of all my hang-ups. Praying is a dangerous thing. Wind up changed, you know.
That's what I'm trying to get across to you. Keep praying. I'm interested in the next part of your prayer. Well, go on.
I'm scared to.
Scared of what?
I know what you'll say.
Try me and see.
Forgive us our sins as we forgive those who sin against us.
What about Anne?
See, I knew it. I knew you were going to bring her up. Why, Lord, she's told lies about me, spread stories about my family. She never paid back the money she owes me. I've sworn I will get even with her.
But your prayer, what about your prayer?
I didn't mean it.
Well, at least you're honest. But it's not much fun carrying that load of bitterness inside of you, is it?
No, but I'll feel better as soon as I get even. Boy, have I got some plans for that neighbor. She'll wish she'd never moved into my neighborhood.
You wouldn't feel any better. You'll feel worse. Revenge isn't sweet. Think of how unhappy you are now. But I can change all that.
You can? How?
Forgive Anne. Then I'll forgive you. Then the hate and sin will be Anne's problem. Not yours. You will have settled your heart.
Oh, all right. You always are. And more than I want to get revenge against Anne, I want to be right with you. But all right. I forgive her. Help her to find the right road in life, Lord. She's bound to be awfully miserable now that I think about it. Who goes around doing the things she does to others has to be out of it. Some way, somehow, show her the right way.
There, now. Wonderful. How do you feel?
Well, not bad. I feel pretty great. You know, I don't think I'll have to go to bed uptight tonight for the first time since I can remember. Maybe I won't be so tired from now on because of not getting enough rest.
You're not through with your prayers.
Oh.
Come on.
All right. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil.
Good. Good. I'll do that. Just don't put yourself in a place where you can be tempted.
What do you mean by that?
Don't turn the TV on when you know the laundry needs to be done and the house needs to be picked up. Also, about the time you spend with your friends. If you can't influence the conversation to positive things, perhaps you should rethink the value of those friendships. Another thing, your neighbors and friends shouldn't be your standard for keeping up. And please don't use me as an escape hatch.
I don't understand that last part.
Sure you do. You've done it a lot of times. You get caught in a bad situation. You get in trouble. And then you're coming running to me. Lord, help me out of this mess, and I promise I'll never do it again. You remember some of those bargains you tried to make with me?
Yes, and I'm ashamed, Lord. I really am.
Which bargain are you remembering?
Well, there was the night my spouse was gone and the children and I were home alone. The wind was blowing so hard I thought the roof would be gone any minute, and tornado warnings were out. I remember saying, "Oh God, if you spare us, I'll never skip my devotions again."
I protected you, but you didn't keep your promise, did you?
I'm sorry, Lord, I really am. Up until now, I thought if I just prayed the Lord's Prayer every day, then I could do what I liked. I didn't expect anything to happen like this.
Go ahead and finish your prayer.
For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever. Amen.
Do you know what would bring me glory? What would really make me happy?
No, I don't know. I want to please you. I can see what a mess I've made of my life. Now I can see how great it would be to be really one of your followers.
You just answered the question.
I did?
Yes. The thing that would bring me glory is to have people like you truly love me. And I see that happening between us. Now that some of these old sins are exposed and out of the way, there is no telling what we can do together.
Lord, let's see what you and I can do to me. Okay?
Yes. Less.
Example of what the Lord's Prayer might mean if we took it seriously. Am I slipping, Ron? Oh, it's... Yeah, I think I've curved the wrong way. It's all Linda's fault, huh? Yeah. Some things we might learn from the Lord's Prayer. We talk about our Father. Some of us have good relations with our Father, and that makes it easy. But Jesus specified that this was our Father in heaven, our perfect Father. We come to worship Him. We acknowledge that we want God's will and plans to be done here as it is in heaven. We acknowledge that God is God and we are not. And there's a lot of things that aren't in our control. We ask God for the things that we need. We confess our sins and repent, or as the common English puts it, we change our lives and hearts. We turn back towards God. And then we request protection and help in overcoming sin and Satan's attacks on us. It's kind of interesting that this prayer has been used for centuries, and yet often we say it without knowing what we're saying. We say it, we don't pray it. There's a difference. I've mentioned before, when I was on the tour in Israel with the Episcopal group, all of their services include the Lord's Prayer. And they said it so fast, I could not keep up. Of course, I'm used to kind of slowing it down. I was literally out of breath when we finished the Lord's Prayer. I'm thinking, if we're talking to our best friend, if we're talking to God, we don't rush it. When you sit down with someone you love, do you speak as fast as you can to get it through, get it done? No, you spend time, you savor that relationship. It's important to us. We want it to last. And that should be the way with the Lord's Prayer. Jesus teaches us that God is our parent in heaven. The Apostle Paul mentioned later that in Aramaic, Jesus used Abba, which would be daddy. It's what a little child calls their father. When we say, "Our Father who art in heaven," it's totally different if we say, "Hey, Daddy, can we talk?" But that's what Jesus had in mind. Imagine a little child comes up to you and jabbers away. They may not be up to language yet, but it's still fun, isn't it? They know what they're saying, even if you don't. And they have a ball saying it. Hallowed be thy name. That's an area I struggle with because we have gotten to the point that God is just our best friend. We're sitting down over a cup of coffee with him. I don't know if God drinks coffee or not, but I think he must. He's up all the time, so yeah, got to have some caffeine. I don't know if we remember that it's God we're talking to and how awesome God is because we have gotten so familiar. And yet, if Jesus started by calling him Daddy, there's a real personal relationship and connection that is to grow out of this prayer and out of the scriptures. We don't study the Bible just for the sake of knowing the book. We study the Bible so we know the author, that we get to know God. And that's the relationship we're working on when we pray. And that is, as Cindy read from the gospel today, our relationship with God. That is the vertical part of the cross. It also, in order to love God, requires us to reach out the horizontal part of the cross to other people. And that's where we have a problem. Because we can love God, but when it gets down to loving people, there's some of them who are not very lovable, let's face it. We can say they're all made in God's image, but sometimes some people hide God's image really well. They have built up walls through the experiences of their life, or the fact that they've never gotten close to God, or they have misconceptions about who God really is. And it makes it hard to see the image of God inside them. We pray, thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. I can't imagine God ignoring anyone in heaven. But there are some people I would rather not meet again, if we're honest. Yeah, there's several. Still working on it. We're always a work in progress. We want to be aligned with God's will. We want to submit to his plans. And yet, as in the little reading skit before, that requires us to do something. We can't just say the words. What are we doing to make God's will done here on earth? The next couple of weeks, we have one opportunity at least. Are you voting your values? On whatever the race is, whether it's one of the big ticket ones or not, we need to be voting our beliefs. We need to think about which candidate is closest to what we think God would have done. Sometimes that's tough because we see imperfect people and we have to find the best we can do. Give us this day our daily bread. I like the bread. But it's not just our food that we need, physical food. We also need our spiritual and mental food. We need our daily rest. We need to be connected to God and to one another. We have certain needs as a person. We need to come back to God often. And some of us pray a little bit through the day, here and there, as situations come up. Some people set aside that prayer room, that war room, as the movie called it, where you can go in and be alone with God and be intense in prayer. Other times we say a prayer as we're driving. God bless that other driver who just cut me off. But we can be in constant prayer like that as situations arise. Someone's broken down on the side of the road. Yes, you can say a prayer. When you know someone is having a difficult time and you saw something on Facebook, I know Cindy follows a lot of, I don't know, I think you got a few thousand friends and you follow various kids and so forth who are in need. And those of you in Closer Walk, if you're on that prayer group, there are needs almost daily that come through. There's no shortage of things to pray for, that's for sure. We pray for forgiveness as we forgive others. And sometimes we'll use trespasses, some use debts or sins. Regardless of what word we plug in there, we're reminded that God forgives us and expects us to forgive others. Oh, we often fail on that one, don't we? It's much more human and satisfying to plan your revenge, much like that skit earlier. The other part is we need to be careful where we put ourselves, not to put ourselves in the way of temptation. If you have a gambling problem, you shouldn't go to the casino. If you have a drinking problem, you shouldn't go to the bar. But oh, they are so convenient. Is it any better to take it home? We can gamble from the computer. We can certainly drink at home. Our society has probably hundreds of ways of tempting us. Now I think about almost all of them would be available on the internet, which comes to almost all of our homes. It can be a scary place, or it can be a wonderful resource. Depends on how we use it. Good place to ask for God's guidance. And then the prayer ends with a doxology, a hymn of praise, for thine is the kingdom and the glory and the power forever. That's the way we live our lives, isn't it? Or it should be. Acknowledging that God is in control, that he's God and we're not. Thank goodness. I would not want to have to deal with all that he does. And yet, we admit there are times we would like to know what his plan is, because it seems like he is silent at times. We know that God answers every prayer. If it's not a yes, it's usually a not yet, because I have something better planned. But oh, is waiting tough. We certainly admit that. Prayer. Used as an example, we can say it regularly. I hope we pray it regularly. And I hope that our lives demonstrate what we're saying, that we really mean it. Because it's just one more way of getting to know God. And that's really what he wants from us, is that relationship, not just a rote thing that we do all the time. Let's pray. Oh God, you taught us to honor you, to be willing to come with our confessions, to come with our needs, and to always remember that you are with us. We come and we offer ourselves in the name of Jesus the Christ. Amen. Oh God, would you accept these offerings? Bless them as we return our tithes and offerings. May they be used to serve you by serving others. We pray in Jesus' name. Amen.
As we lift our voices in unison in the prayer that Jesus taught us, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen. Would you receive our benediction? Blessings upon you and those you love, and those you shall never know. Blessings upon your steps and upon the visions of your eyes. Blessings upon you in all circumstances. Blessings be upon what lies before you. Blessings on you, my friends in Christ. Amen.